Bob and Sherry, sponsored by Bank of America Customized Cash Rewards Credit Card. You can earn 3% cash back on online shopping, making the essentials even more rewarding. Here's Bob and Sherry.
It's the Bob and Sherry Show.
Seems like a waste of time, but sure, go nuts. What do I care? I'd rather go home.
With Bob.
Is he the worst? Is he an unspeakable abomination? Does the very thought of him make your skin crawl?
Laughs at his own jokes, but otherwise he's okay.
And Sherry.
Bad attitude, insubordination, not great.
And now, broadcasting from the palatial Bob and Sherry Studios, it's Bob and Sherry.
Well, we welcome everybody. Thank you for being with the Bob and Sherry Show. Sherry, how are you doing today? Everything all right?
Going the way you like it? Yeah, I'm all right. I'm gonna admit this is the first day since the pandemic began that I'm actually just working in my pajamas. I'm not proud of that. It is the first day. But yeah, I'm just going to admit it because I feel like if I admit it and say it out loud, I won't keep repeating it. This won't be the beginning of a long downward slide into my crazy cat lady future. But yeah, I got up this morning.
That's going to be impossible. So just embrace it, okay?
I got up this morning and took a shower and I'm standing there in the bathroom and I thought, you know what? No, Satan, I am not putting on hard pants. Absolutely not. I just put on pajamas and here I am. Hope
all right, totally
doing
relaxed.
Well.
I want to start out with an appearance by an actor whose name is Ken Jeong. And if you saw The Hangover, and I think he was in The Hangover 2, if you saw him on The Voice as one of the judges, you might have seen him in Knocked Up. He is the Asian American actor who is also a doctor. He's a real life doctor who at one point just said, you know, I think that I'm going to get into this showbiz thing. He studied, according to Max, he studied at Duke University and then went to UNC for medical school. My stepson, Ramsey, had the same route. So he's a very, very smart guy. And he was on James Corbin's show, the Late Late Show, the other day. And Corbin asked him, all right, what about these shots? Where do we stand right now? So if you'd like a little bit of an explanation from an amusing guy who's also extremely smart and a doctor, here we go.
We're 18 months into this pandemic.
Yep.
When you look at it, you look at where we are now, when you look back at where we've been through this crazy journey, what do you think could have been done better?
Real talk. I mean, I just think in the medical community, I think we need to do a better job just sending out information that even we did not anticipate this coming.
Right.
And I think that there's so much misinformation out there, and not just by extremists, there's so much confusion. And I think, I just think we could have done a better job messaging, just like this came unexpected. We were unprepared for this because prior to May and June, that we didn't know the Delta variant would be the predominant strain globally, which is like if you, and I don't mean to talk all scientists, I don't mean to be all Fauci on you, but I'm saying the Delta variant, what makes it so contagious is that the amount of virus in your nasopharynx is 1,000 times the concentration of the original COVID strain.
Whoa.
That's why it's so infectious. That's why we're all wearing masks. That's why, and we were not prepared for that because think of like the vaccines as an umbrella and it's just protecting you from rain. And if you got the Pfizer, Moderna, you got a double umbrella protecting you from the rain. But with this Delta variant, you have that double umbrella and there's a monsoon, there's a hurricane coming down. You're going to get wet. You're going to get affected. And so I think we need to do a better job just saying, hey, we have to go, you know, bear down, play some defense more, and hopefully, fingers crossed, if this is the final wave, some medical experts may say, you heard it here first from me, I'm praying that it is. If that's the case, that this Delta surge does pass in a few months, then there can be some form of population immunity where we can all have some semblance of normality, at least in the spring of 2022.
And there it is. You know, the Delta variant, it occurs to me, is like a really horrible guest that you have invited to a party. He shows up, you don't know anything about him, and he's brutish, he's rude, he's causing people to be uncomfortable, and you're trying to figure out who is this dude and what do I need to do to kind of, you know, understand what I need to do with him. You know, the medical community gets hammered. Why didn't you know this? Well, this thing just showed up. They're trying to figure it out on the fly.
The thing that really got my attention when he said it, there was 1,000 times more virus in your nose and throat than
me too.
with regular COVID. Oh my God, yeah. That's all I'm going to think about now.
Yeah, yeah, that's right.
Y'all don't sneeze or cough on each other, and don't lick each other. I think that's good advice at all times.
At all times.
But especially powerful right now. Keep it here. We got a big Wednesday show for you today. We have comedian Dan Mangini. We have the real woman who inspired what we think of as a witch. Pointy black hat, warts, black cat, all of that. How the ancient Romans whitened their teeth. You'll be so grateful to be alive in a time of crest. You just don't even know. Morons in the News coming up. It's Bob and Sherry.
Instant access to the podcast, and fun side. Just download the free Bob and Sherry app.
So in a couple of hours and change, Sherry is going to bring us a segment on witches. That's right. We're right around the corner from Halloween. Everything in Salem, Massachusetts is getting all cranked up. You know, they have a big influx of people from all over the world, all over the country, visiting that little town right on the seacoast in Massachusetts. And you can go through the actual witch house where one of the witches lived. So that's a little bit later on. We'll give you some more information about that town, too. And speaking of that sort of thing, this is random, but I saw this yesterday. Tonight at work, a creepy dude asked me, quote, "What's your secret to staying so slim and perky?" I responded, "I'm a 1,000-year-old witch, and every morning I bathe in the blood of men I've sacrificed." And then she goes on to say there was an older lady nearby who heard the whole thing, and she laughed out loud. And the person who posted that said, "Pretty sure this makes us an official coven." That's pretty, you know, I mean, that's pretty fast on your feet, unless this happens so much to this woman that's her go-to line, just to shut it down. As a woman, what do you think? Was it off the top of her head, or is that her go-to line?
It had to be off the top of her head the first time. So this is either the go-to, or this is the first time, and it's going to become the go-to. I can't believe you're talking about this. I was reading an article in the New York Post about this dating coach in Manhattan. Mm-hmm. You pay $10,000. To have this dating coach work with you on your online dating profiles, your flirting techniques, like, you know, all of the things that you're doing wrong. And she says a lot of the times you're attracting the wrong people online dating because your bio and your photos don't really reflect anything about who you are. Like you put very little information in your bio, you know, other than, you know, fun loving Pisces, you know, enjoys
loves the beach.
Live music, the beach, right? And then you post pictures of yourself out at parties and big social events and having a good time. But she said that's completely wrong. Until your in your online dating profiles reflect your core values and who you really are, you're not going to attract the right people. So then she said there's a 4-point checklist that my clients use on the third date to determine if this is something that can become a relationship. So I'm going to share what she said, and you'll get it for free. It's usually $10,000. So this is after the third date, right? The first thing you want to do is by the third date, you have to make sure that you and this person are connecting on some sort of level. It could be spiritual, it could be intellectual, it could be physical, but there one of these things has to be sparking. There has to be that connection. And then the second thing is, this is again, date three, you have to make sure that your core values are aligned. Does this person have similar perspectives on religion or career goals, family, all of that? If they don't, this relationship, this according to this dating coach, you need to just end it and move on to the next one. The next thing is you have to be able to be a good judge of that other person's emotional maturity. A good sign of whether that person is emotionally available for a relationship is if they're clearly articulating their feelings. If there's any kind of drama or any hint of ghosting, you're out of there. And finally, you have to be honest with yourself. Ask yourself, is this person ready for the relationship I want? And if you can't answer that yes, you need to move on and try somebody else. Don't waste
that. Makes sense.
It does make sense, right? But in the real world, we were just talking about this. In the real world, we see these things that are problems and we go, oh, but you know, maybe I'm just being too judgmental, or I'm not giving this person a chance.
Or I'm so wonderful, they'll change once they're with me for a couple of weeks.
Meanwhile, this coach says, after you've given me $10,000, you're going to listen to what I say, which is really true. Yeah, so what you might not do for yourself for nothing, maybe if you had money in it, skin in the game, maybe then you would go, yeah, this person's really adorable or whatever, but no, I just know this isn't right. What do you think?
Yeah, yeah. Well, I mean, all of those things make sense. They all make sense. The hard thing for people, I think, is especially if there's no one in their life and they feel embarrassed about that for whatever reason, their friends are saying, have you met anybody? Blah, blah, blah. The tendency with a lot of folks is, okay, this guy is not horrible. As a matter of fact, he's got a few things that are pretty good. I don't like this and this, but let's give it a ride. Maybe I'm not judging, because you want to be with somebody. Whereas you need to jump out of the boat, according to this expert, at certain times.
So my question for you was, do you think you'd be more likely to follow those four steps if you had $10,000 invested versus if you were just freestyling on your own?
Yes.
I think so too. And I think that's why 70% of her clients are married within 6 months of meeting someone this way. 30%, it's even quicker. Like, they find their person almost instantly. So isn't it kind of sad and funny that until it's costing us money, we're just willing to throw ourselves onto human grenades? Right?
Well, it's also interesting that the rich have it better than all of us, seemingly in every way.
In every way.
Because that's a lot of money. That's a lot of money for a consultant.
Morons in the News is next. It's Bob and Sherry.
We've got him.
Morons.
With Bob and Sherry.
He's a moron.
It's Morons in the News.
So the country of New Zealand is really locked down on COVID. Parts of the country you can drive into, you know, the town that's the next town to your town, and you can get some takeout. But in Auckland, which is the capital, they are really serious. They're saying you can't get takeout, you can't be driving into certain areas, stay home. Well, some police were patrolling back roads and they noticed a suspicious looking vehicle. It was a car, and the car did a U-turn and sped off. Eventually, it pulled over. And they found out that the guys in there were local mobsters, okay? And they talked to them, and they said, you're going to need to open up the trunk. And when you ask a mobster to open the trunk, you don't know what you're going to get. Mm-hmm. Police found in the trunk a large quantity of money, $70,000 in cash, and empty ounce bags for some sort of drugs, presumably marijuana, and three buckets of KFC chicken and 10 cups of coleslaw. Also,
hard stuff.
A package of fries and four large bags containing other KFC items. And I'm going to guess it's those extremely hot potatoes. Please, those mashed potatoes, please be careful with those things. The two men were aged 23 and 30. They're going to appear in court. The police officer spoke with them and he said, this is very dangerous coming into a place that has COVID. You know, you're not supposed to be doing that. And you know what else is dangerous? You should have gotten the broiled chicken, not the fried. I mean, are you just looking for problems there, buddy?
The cholesterol.
Yeah. Those are some hardcore New Zealand gangsters.
Oh, yeah.
Bringing in the KFC like that.
That's right, yeah.
Today's moron of the day is Ivor Ruiz. He was pulled over when cops saw a blue Chevy pickup truck driving with its turn signal on for nearly a mile and drifting back and forth between lanes, also going 15 miles over the speed limit. So deputies pulled the truck over, and they discovered the driver, Ivor Ruiz, and he smelled of alcohol, and his speech was slurred and slow, and he denied that he was drunk. He said, I was drinking earlier. And then the deputies asked him to step out of the car for a sobriety test. And that's when they realized that Mr. Ruiz had no pants on. He was naked from the waist down. And so,
which is a good look for almost any man, by the way.
Everyone just kind of stood there staring at each other. And then Mr. Ruiz said, "I'll put some pants on." And everyone was very appreciative of that. At that point, it was time to do the roadside sobriety test. And we actually have body cam video. And I've never been pulled over for DUI. I'm assuming the majority of our listeners haven't. This is what it sounds like.
Okay, so you're not wanting to finish SFSEs?
No.
Okay, I do want you to understand that if you do decide that you don't... Okay, but I have to explain it to you. If you do decide that you don't want to complete field sobriety, okay, I have to make a determination based on what I've observed.
Yep.
Okay, your driving pattern. Okay, speaking to you, I smell the odor of alcohol coming off your breath. Your eyes are very red.
Okay.
Okay, your speech is slurred.
Which is natural for me, but...
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. And then when I come over here and I do HGN... I see a lot of nystagmus.
Okay.
Okay, so I want you to understand that. If you decide you don't want to continue, you're giving up your opportunity to show me that you're not impaired.
I understand everything you're saying.
Okay, and with that in mind, you don't want to do it anymore?
No.
Okay, just go ahead and turn around and put your hands behind your back for me. You are under arrest for DUI at this point.
The best part about the... Go ahead.
He's a big, big, big guy.
Yeah, that might be a good idea.
Naked from the waist down. And Max... Tell them how many pairs of handcuffs.
They had to use two pairs of handcuffs because he was so big. Because he couldn't get his arms around his body.
He is a big man.
Well,
we're
going to
post this on Facebook. I don't know what you're drinking that makes you want to cruise around in your pickup late at night without your pants on, but it's strong.
He had no shirt on in the video, so I'm guessing he was completely naked when he was driving around.
I guess it's still grabbed pretty
the shirt
hot
when the police came over.
It's pretty hot in Volusia County, Florida, still. The other plot twist here is this guy is a police officer who has since turned in his resignation.
You are kidding me.
Folks, the demon liquor. We'll post this up on the Bob and Sherry Facebook so you can learn from these mistakes. The first mistake being keep your pants on when you're out drinking and driving. This is Bob and Sherry.
Get Bob and Sherry swag in our store at bobandsherry.com.
Max shared a wild story with me about this island in the Caribbean, Montserrat, who this is an island. It was like everything was wiped out by a volcano, but this is a legendary island in rock music circles. The Police have recorded there. The Rolling Stones have recorded there. It's a paradise with black sand beaches and just absolutely perfect. Well, Montserrat created this remote worker program where you could come. You're not allowed to visit as a tourist. There's no tourism right now in Montserrat. But if you pass a very, very rigorous background check and you earn at least $70,000 a year, you can come live there as a remote worker. And you have to be quarantined for 2 weeks when you first get there. And then you have to pass your coronavirus test. And if all of that goes down, you can live on this tiny remote Caribbean island. And there's no sickness on the island at all. So there are no masks. There's no social distancing. There are very few people there. And only 21 people have qualified for this remote worker program. But it's kind of paradise for the people that are there. Doesn't that sound amazing?
It does. If there are things to do in addition to your work, I mean, if there are restaurants, if there are grocery stores, if, you know, you can have some sort of a life that resembles a little bit what you had before.
You have all of that. But of course, it's, you know, there are very few people who live on the island. So everything's at a smaller scale. You might not have a bunch of restaurants or grocery stores to choose from. But they go to this family that was profiled in this. Her kids go to daycare. They go they go out to dinner. They go to art shows. They live in a beautiful rented villa. They go to the beach. And because the whole family had been living in a really cramped New York City apartment under quarantine, they're like,
"Yeah, it's heaven.
This is the best."
Yeah,
And the residents are like, "Yeah, it's we're glad they're here, but for the Montserrat has never been about tourism." I learned this in this article that they make all their money from exporting volcanic sand. Which is something to think about, right? Yeah. But they did get some tourism. Typically, day tourists would come over from Antigua and just kind of explore the island. So they're not really, there's no dollars coming in from this.
Yeah, yeah.
But right. Starting October 1st, which is next week, if you're vaccinated, you'll be allowed to come visit the island. The remote worker program will continue, but they will allow day tourists with proof of vaccines back on. It's just,
so right now, the real plus is that you can take yourself, your spouse, your family, or whomever, and not worry about the virus. You can be free.
Everyone's totally free. There is not one case of coronavirus on this island.
Wow.
Now, I'm just imagining what it would be like. Your job went remote, and you knew about this and could do it. Can you imagine how cool that must be for the handful of people that qualified for this?
Yeah, I agree. As long as the place is safe and there's something to do, you know, I think that would be fantastic. If you're the type of person that can embrace island life, because it is different than living on a mainland.
At this point, I think I could embrace shipping container life just because it would be a little something different.
I think a lot of people.
Yeah.
A lot of
straight ahead, comedian Dan Mangini. This is Bob and Sherry. Do you own or rent your home? Sure you do. And I bet it can be hard work. You know, it's easy bundling policies with Geico. Geico makes it easy to bundle your homeowners or renters insurance along with your auto policy. And it's a good thing too, because you already have so much to do around your home. Just go to geico.com, get a quote, and see how much you could save. It's Geico easy. Visit geico.com today. That's geico.com.
Bob and Sherry, sponsored by Bank of America Customized Cash Rewards Credit Card. You can earn 3% cash back on online shopping, making the essentials even more rewarding. Here's Bob and Sherry.
It is that time. Time for Everyone Needs a Laugh. Here is comedian Dan Mangini.
I love getting groceries, man. I love buying food. But when I get to the cashier and they're like, Dan, paper or plastic? I'm like, well, if you choose paper, you get home, that's like 12 trips from your car to the kitchen. Plastic? One trip. Because you pop open the trunk and then weave these fingers through 95 handles. Then you lift them. All right, left side. Wait a minute, these bags are lighter. Hold on, let me put the milk over here. Now we're balanced. Oh my gosh, how am I gonna close the trunk? For me, that 20-second walk to the house, most grueling part of my entire week. Mumbling, man, I gotta work out, man, I gotta work out, man, I gotta work out. Finally get to the front door, and it's like, dang it! The keys are in my pocket. So you gotta put down the bag, unlock the door, pick up the bag, and reweave your fingers. Always miss that one handle, just praying your bananas don't fall out. By the time I get to the kitchen counter, there's no blood left in my hands. Hurts to straighten my fingers out. Then I'm stuck with that kung fu grip for 6 weeks. Should have chose paper, but no, it was worth it because we made one trip, and now we got bags for our bathroom trash cans. Still nothing from the old timer. Good looking man, but I feel like he's just staring at me, waiting for me to call out bingo numbers right now. I can't buy a laugh from this whole front row. Every time I look at him, I feel like I got 50 cents in my pocket and I'm walking through a dollar store. We got a smile. He was scaring me for a minute, you know what I mean? They say if you want to have a great show, you just get on stage and match the energy of the front row. But frankly, I don't feel like taking a nap right now. My friends love my observational material. You know, I got great friends. And three of these guys want me to help them move next month. And I'm a great guy, so that ain't going to happen. No, I don't mind all that heavy lifting. You know what I mean? That's what dudes do. I just don't want to sit in your house and pretend that we're trying to figure out where all your stuff goes. Because let me tell you right now, do you know what controls the whole layout of the furniture in your bedroom? The cable jack. It's like the architects were messing with us when they built the place. Hey, Eugene, come here. Let me show you what I did. I put it between the closet and the bathroom. smallest strip of wall in the entire house. No TV's gonna fit there, baby. Which means the bed has to go right here, so in the morning the sun will shine through the window right on their faces. Go check out the living room. I put the jack in the fireplace. I hate, and I mean hate, walking into that new empty bedroom and trying to figure out which one of the 10 sockets is controlled by the light switch. All right, let me plug my lamp into this one. Light switch. Gosh! Let me try the one next to it. Maybe that's what the builder had in mind. Light switch. Man, what could possibly be wrong? Oh, there's no light bulb in here. Hey, sockets in a room, never where I need them. You know what I mean? Everything's wireless these days, but when I was growing up, you were like, well, the phone jack's here, but my desk needs to go there. Looks like I'll buy a 27-foot phone cord and wrap it over the door, over the closet, over the bathroom, underneath the carpet. Which means the bed goes here, the alarm clock plugs in there, and that's the socket that's controlled by the light switch.
That is comedian Dan Mangini. That'll be up on our website, BOBANDSHERI.com. We have a ton of stuff on the website. We have information on all of our podcasts, the regular Bob and Sherry Show podcast, Fun Size, the Oddcast. We have our newsletter, which we send out once a month. We never spam you. And every week we draw a subscriber and load them down with prizes and Bob and Sherry swag. So you should definitely subscribe because it's a really fun thing. It'll hit your inbox once a month, but you can win a prize this week. BOBANDSHERI.com. This is Bob and Sherry.
Congratulations, Sherry Lynch, named one of the most influential women in radio again this year. It's Bob and Sherry.
We live in challenging times. You know, we do. There's a lot going on in the world right now, and a lot of it's hard. But there are things that we have, even in our hardest and most difficult times, that make our lives better than those of, well, let me just use the ancient Romans as the example for this conversation. So last night, haven't finished dinner, having a glass of wine, curled up on the couch, and I'm reading how in ancient Rome, one of the hottest commodities was urine. And it was so popular as a commodity that people would collect it from public urinals and sell it. And there was a special.
So this was before Shasta. This was before Shasta, I guess.
When I tell you what they were using it for.
Where are we going here, baby? Where are we going?
Because I want everybody to stop bitching about how hard life is when I tell you what they were using it for in ancient Rome.
Okay, that makes total sense.
I'm so tired. Every time I swipe into one of my socials, a bunch of people whining and crying about something.
Say it all, sister.
You think your life is hard, Karen, because you have to wear a mask at CVS? Wait till you hear what they did in ancient Rome. Wait till you hear. Sit your whole butt down and get prepared to get a little bit of learning shoved into you. People would go into the public urinals in ancient Rome, and they would collect urine. And if they sold it, they had to pay a special urine tax on it. It was considered liquid gold. Now, there were lots of uses for the urine. What were they selling it for?
They still do that in Connecticut, by the way. Go ahead.
One thing I learned, they sold it to tanners who would use it to soften leather. And they also sold it to gunsmiths who used it to produce gunpowder. But there was another use for this golden liquid, this ancient Roman urine. And it was best to let it fester for this purpose. Like they would, if you were going to sell it for this, you would set it out in the sun and let it fester and concentrate, because that would give the urea in the human urine time to convert to ammonia.
Hey, Bob, did you think when you got up this morning you were going to talk about festering urine?
No.
Okay, are you ready? Oh, I'm sorry.
I'm ready to go over to, sports radio is what I'm ready for right
now.
Wait a minute.
I'm sorry. What was that? What was that, Chad? You don't like hand sanitizer. Wait till you hear what the ancient Romans did with buckets of festering urine. They used it as a tooth whitener.
No, you're kidding.
Lord.
After the urine was allowed to fester in the sun in a pail, it would concentrate the ammonia, and the ammonia was believed to clear teeth of their stains. I guess like a lot of red wine or what have you back in ancient Rome. So you think your life is hard now? Do you? Do you? You have Crest white strips. You have Zoom teeth whitening. Freaking Julius Caesar was rinsing with day-old...
And by the way, the influencer was Larry King. Even back then, he was selling that product, and he did a heck of a job, I understand.
I am Larry King for festering urine.
Well, you know, it's supposed to, I don't know about the festering part, but the substance itself is pure. So I'm trying to put a soft little spin on this, and boy, it's difficult.
It is not
well, thanks
difficult.
For that,
it is
thanks
always
for that
important.
Update.
It is
yeah.
always important to have perspective.
Oh,
and to
yeah.
remember
you know, you're
that
right.
our hard times now, we stand on yeah. the shoulders
right.
of giants who had whiter smiles because they were gargling with festering urine.
Yeah.
Things are hard, but we have many mm-hmm. comforts. And we have many,
we do.
Many
We don't have to do that.
And
yeah,
we have a lot
right.
to be thankful for. And if
oh,
you
yeah.
have urine in your mouth today, it's because you're a pervert, not because you want a whiter smile.
I'm thankful for the end of this segment.
It's Bob and Sherry.
Leave us a talk back with the free Bob and Sherry app.
Hello, American workers. Whether you're working from home, you're working from the office because you're back in the office, you're working out of your car, you're working out of your truck, wherever you're working, the times, they are a-changing. I read in the Atlantic magazine over the weekend that managers are now losing jobs because their bosses feel they're not, in some cases, not all, but in some cases, not as important as they once were. Companies are reassessing. Is it okay to let the employees kind of manage themselves? Now, if you are a manager, a middle manager, you know, don't shoot the messenger here. But they're just saying that with certain cases, if you had a manager who was one of these people that didn't really produce anything, but just kind of pointed out what was wrong about YOU, those jobs are becoming scarce because people in some cases are working at home. And if you're a manager, it's hard to control people who are working at home. So if the company is bought into at-home work, even part-time, they might be saying, I don't need this man or woman over here. We're going to save that job. I find that interesting. I think like in radio, you've got to have programming managers. And I'm sure in restaurants, you've got to have managers. But there probably are some situations where this is a manager who's, you know, just kind of like, what have you been up to? You know, awfully long break there for lunch. And those people are evidently getting gone. And that position will be closed in the future. After reading that, I saw some posts of employees who are ticked off at managers. So let's couple that and see what they're saying. These are actual posts online. This is from Jord. Still not over my manager calling me into the office of my minimum wage job in a chain restaurant and telling me that he didn't feel like, quote, my heart was in it. It's not. This isn't what I blanking want to do with the rest of my life. Another one. Who is this from? Landon Craner. I always hate when bosses are flummoxed to find out you're there for the money. Quote, one said, you shouldn't be here for the money. Unquote. Why else would I be here? I have to pay bills. If I was a millionaire, my butt would not be in here. Have you ever had a boss say that you shouldn't do it for these people? They're not here for the money. I did.
I actually have a friend who works in our business who was told, mm-hmm. if your attitude is you want to get paid, you're never going to be successful. Like, wait, what?
What?
Wait, what?
See, that's the manager that's going to lose the job because he or she is completely out of touch. I used to have a boss. This is Red Sky at Night. I used to have a boss who would tell me my drafts were terrible. I would take them back, wait 24 hours, and then submit them without making any changes at all. And every time he'd say, all right, now, this is much better. Clueless blank. I still think about when my manager told me, quote, so why don't you just quit then? I did. And then 10 plus people followed. You really played yourself well there, sir. That's happening. That's happening right now.
Yeah. Yeah.
When I was assistant manager of a place which paid its regular employees minimum wage, the regional manager once said to me, "I'm sick of putting people in the bare minimum effort required." He seemed genuinely shocked when I replied, "What rate of pay are they on?" The bare minimum is what they were on.
I see. This is one of those debates that I see all the time, usually on Twitter. People furious, you know, well, nobody wants to work in this country anymore. And so there was this whole thread of, you know, nobody wants to work in this country. And this person was like, "I work as a server and people are coughing on me and spitting on me and I'm making $2 an hour plus tips, which I'm not getting." And the response to that was, "Well, maybe if you had some ambition." So like the,
oh boy,
it's an argument there where there's never like the goalposts just keep moving and moving and moving. Right?
Yeah. It's just, I don't know where it's going, but I think everybody believes that there is some sort of a reset that's going on. This one is from Sharon Bauer, and Sharon says, "It doesn't always stop with low paying jobs. I stumped a manager at a large company who asked me, 'Don't you think we have your best interests at heart?' I said, 'No, I think you'd sell me for my organs if you thought that was the best way to make money off of me.'" That's pretty good on the, you know, right on her sheet. Someone who's known as Dirt said, "One of my old bosses was like, 'We're a team. That means you have to act like an owner.' I said, 'This isn't an owner's paycheck in my account here.'" You got to be careful about that. You do have to be careful about that. So, there you are. Times they are changing.
My daughter's first job, she's in 10th grade.
Yeah.
So her first job, the owner of the company said to her, "You know, if you don't act like you own this place, you never will." And this is my daughter. "I'm sorry, what? I don't own this place. I have an English test." Like, what are you doing talking to a 15-year-old like that? It's Bob and Sherry.
Swag you can use. Just hit shop at bobandsherry.com.
I wish that I had known when my children were babies that I should just relax and be completely chill, because it didn't matter what I did or didn't do. No matter how many vegetables I cooked, no matter how many curfews I enforced, they were going to do and be exactly who they are. And then the minute they left this house, they would become all of the things that I failed. And here's a perfect example. So I a couple of days ago, I went and visited my youngest child at her school. Both of my girls are about an hour and a half away from home, so in opposite directions, so that I, you know, I can go see them if I really need to. And there was some stuff going on, so I decided that I would bring Kara Mia some things and go visit her. And so, you know, her dorm room is immaculate, but that didn't surprise me because her bedroom at home is immaculate. She's very organized. She turned in a paper that was due tomorrow, a week early. I mean, she's a great student. She's really on top of it. And so I said, "Honey, you look really good. You look really healthy. You look really happy." And she said, "Well, I just decided that I needed to just suck it up and be an adult and eat vegetables and oatmeal and exercise. So that's what I'm doing."
Wow.
I said,
Before you sigh, better late than never.
Yeah. I said, can you go get your RA? Cause I may need medical attention. I'm just like, I'm feeling kind of dizzy. I'm feeling kind of faint. She said, "Yeah, like I went to the dining hall with my friends and I had chicken and broccoli and it was pretty good. And I'm eating oatmeal now. And then, you know, I go to the gym at 7:30 in the morning and run on the treadmill." And I'm looking at her and I said, I always knew this was going to happen. I knew. And if I could have trusted the process, we would have just eaten marshmallows for dinner, you know,
TV shows, nothing but mac and cheese.
Yeah. I mean, I just would have put in so much less work. And I said, what triggered this? And she said, "Well," and this was the really, she goes, "Well, it's not like I didn't know you were right. I just didn't want to hear it." Ow!
That's an honest answer. That's an honest answer. And like I said, better late than never. I mean, a great many, both boys and girls, when they go off to college, put on like, what, 10, 15 pounds the first year and a half, 2 years?
Well, and she told me she's like so-and-so, they just have boxes of Kit Kats and stuff in their room. But I, she goes, I've kind of done that. Like, I've lived my sweet tooth and I'm sort of over it. And so I'm laughing, and you're right. Better late than never, not complaining. Here's the challenge. How can new parents skip all of these steps? How can they just go right from, here's your baby, go ahead and take it home, to a decade and a half of mac and cheese and Pop-Tarts, and then the kid figures out vegetables? Because I have spent, like, the best years of my life telling my children, no, you're not finished. You must have a no thank you bite. I have said the phrase no thank you bite. I have said no thank you bite more than Hannibal Lecter. No thank you bite. No thank you bite. No thank you bite. No thank you bite.
She gave you the answer. I knew that you were right. I just wanted to fight you on it. I mean, teenagers are rebellious, and that's what she was doing. If you had not been nagging her or pointing out, you know, left and right, you know, that's just garbage that you're eating when you go out. That's, you know, are you kidding me? You're not going to eat any carrots tonight. If you had not done that and just allowed crappy food for all those years, that never would possibly occur to her. And she might continue eating nothing but junk food.
Maybe.
So as annoying as it is, your payoff actually was there.
Maybe. I knew this. I'm telling you, I always knew. I wasn't surprised. I knew the day would come.
I told you that nothing ticked me off. Well, I won't say nothing. But when I went to Landon's apartment in Chicago, and there's a long hallway from the front to the end of the apartment and a back door, and I walked to go out the back door with the baby, and I saw the sign, make sure this door is locked at night. This means you. Are you kidding me? Are you kidding me? My kids were famous for leaving the doors unlocked in the city for years and years.
That's coming up as we get ready to enter into spooky season, why do we have the mental picture we have of witches? You know, the nose, the wart, the hat, all in black, kind of old, hanging out with a cat. There's a real live woman behind that story, and we've got it for you today. It's coming up. It's Bob and Sherry.
Bob and Sherry, sponsored by Bank of America Customized Cash Rewards Credit Card. You can earn 3% cash back on online shopping, making the essentials even more rewarding. Here's Bob and Sherry.
Bob and Sherry, go.
I think everyone with a head is so, and a TV is so tired of prescription drug commercials. I mean, it's...
Yes.
It's like all, and they advertise a lot on like the true crimey kind of shows that I like to watch. So I am aware of every prescription drug commercial that exists. Well, today's rabbit hole, we ask the question, what's going to happen when all drugs are legal and all drugs can advertise on TV, even stuff like meth?
Like a lot of people, I love to smoke, but my friends and family always make me go outside to do it. So that's why I now use e-meth. It's crystal meth, but electronic. So it produces vapor instead of smoke. And that means I can ride the ice pony anywhere I want.
Smoking is a social thing for me. Without my meth pipe, I don't know what to do with my hands. But now I do know what to do with them. Smoke meth. It's good.
Thanks to e-meth, now I don't even need to leave the bar to get my sweet shabu shabu. Mama can smoke that chunky white crunch anywhere. At the office, at the grocery store, in a bathtub in the middle of the road, or face down in a big old tire.
E-meth is healthier because it doesn't contain antifreeze, but it still has that great meth taste.
E-meth lets me get totally gacked up on Whoop Chicken without yellowing my teeth. See? Perfectly white. What? Hello? See?
Thanks to e-meth, I can now even smoke inside my favorite restaurant.
Excuse me, sir. You can't smoke meth in here.
It's okay. It's electronic.
I don't care. You're in my living room, and you're naked.
E-meth is not for everyone. Talk to your doctor if you experience body rot, face melt, painful death, or fatigue.
E-meth. You know it's good because it's blue.
Oh, God.
Don't even laugh. You know the day is coming.
You know it's called.
Oh, good Lord.
That's Paul at the end from Breaking Bad. That's great.
It's a little tiny Easter egg, yeah, for Breaking Bad fans. We'll post this up on our Facebook so you can watch it. Coming up, there was a real woman once upon a time who inspired the image that we have to this day of a witch. Heading into spooky season, we have her story coming up. It's Bob and Sherry.
Instant access to the podcast, and fun side. Just download the free Bob and Sherry app.
I found the greatest new website. It's called Sad and Useless, the most depressive humor site on the internet. I looked at Sad and Useless, the most depressive humor site on the internet. It's so perfect for the Bob and Sherry show. Hilarious. Let's start out with one of their postings. Hilarious dictionary of Finnish language and culture. Now, I know that sounds like, where's the joke here? But even though it's from Finland, it kind of translates to just about anywhere. These are expressions or words that are Finnish and what they mean. The first one is squat wine. Squat wine is a synonym for a cheap wine. In Finnish liquor stores, the cheapest wines are at the bottom shelves. Therefore, you have to squat to get them. You know, so you go in there going, oh, hi, John. How you doing? You a little squat wine tonight, huh? You still got a job, bud? What's the deal with the squat wine?
We need to steal that because that's true in American stores.
Exactly.
The cheapest wine is always down low. I think we should totally steal that.
Yeah. You know, I never thought about it, but that's the way it is. The expensive stuff is at eye level because that's what they want you to buy, right? The next one from Finland is a slipper hero. That is a man who is completely under his wife's control. Apparently a man so common in Finland, it needed a word, a slipper hero. Either you do it or you cry and do it. That's in order to do what you've been told to do, whether you like it or not. And it's what you, growing up, heard as a Finnish child. Either you do it or you cry and do it. That's true. That's true. And
it
I think that translates.
Like something that my sounds mother, like work. Mother would have said to
yes,
me.
Yes. It translates to over here. This
that
one
sounds
is
like something that greater mediocrity used to say to us.
That's true.
You know,
too.
You're right. You're exactly right. Either you do it or you cry and you do it. Boy, was that those guys. This one is interesting. Read like the devil reads the Bible. That means to read a text and search only for mistakes or the parts that support your own views. In other words, Finns finding only the rankings where Finland is the best. Read like the devil reads the Bible, looking for holes. Looking for something that you can criticize. Is that not a part of our worldwide society, including here in the USA online right now?
That's Twitter. That is Twitter in
that
a
is
nutshell.
Twitter. That is Twitter. This one, I really can't use the whole expression. Let me just say, go in the sock. Go in the sock. To be very silent and to try to stay unnoticed.
Huh. Okay. I mean, I'm wondering what kind of going we're doing in the sock. That's quite a visual.
It sounds like a restroom term from camping.
It sort of is, to be honest with you. Let's just move along to the next one. This one, we have the American version of it, and I bet you you know what it is, even though it kind of is from the past. Take behind the sauna. That's to kill or beat up. Behind a Finnish sauna, you know,
like our version of take it outside, back the woodshed or whatever. Yeah,
or
yeah.
Behind the barn. That's right.
Yeah.
Underpants drunkenness.
I think we all know what that means.
To get loaded in your underwear at home, the word, the myth, the legend. And I think that probably happened more in the last 15, 16 months than it did in all of our history, right? Not have all the moomins in the valley. I don't know what that means. It means to be crazy, the mood after staying just at home for over a year, not have all the moonins in the valley. I just don't know what that one means.
Not playing with a full deck, maybe? I don't know.
Yeah, it's something like that. Like a bear shot in the butt. To be angry in a really bad... He's like a bear who's shot in the butt, and they might use a different word. Here's one that... I don't know that this fits in this day and time. A flower hat aunt. An older woman who is strict about morals and loudly shares her opinions.
Karen.
A person who needs to mind their own business.
It's Karen.
Is... Oh, yeah.
It is.
The Karen.
It is. Yeah.
He's right. You're exactly right. It's the Karen thing, isn't it?
Apologies to all Karens.
Yeah. Usually an older woman who is strict about morals and loudly shares her opinions. Huh. Fresh air poisoning. When you have spent so much time outside that you notice its effects. I don't think I've ever had that. I don't know about that one. In the year of Frankfurter and mashed potatoes, something that happened a long time ago, and an expression that does a good job summarizing Finnish cuisine. Frankfurters
and mashed potatoes. Wow. Well, I'm going to keep squat wine. That's my favorite.
That's my favorite, too. That's my favorite, too. That's right. All right, so there they are over in Finland. Maybe they're not so different from us after all. It's Bob and Cherry.
You read it once.
I don't believe that.
And then you read it again.
I can't believe this.
It's Bob and Cherry's.
I don't believe this.
So as we head into the beginning of spooky season, just want to remind y'all that on this date in 1692, 8 people were hanged as witches in the Salem witch trials, and they were the last people ever hanged in the United States for practicing witchcraft. A total of 19 people were hanged for the crime, and it was this day, 1692, that the last 8 met the hangman at the gallows.
Everybody thinks that they were burned at the stake, but you're right. That's what happened to them.
Well, in honor of that very important historical date, have you ever wondered, where did we get the idea of witches as being old women with pointy hats and sort of hunched posture, you know, who flew on brooms and had black cats as pets and warts and all of that? Where did we get that? Where did we get that idea? Well, we got that idea from a real woman who was prosecuted as a witch. Her name is Mother Stiles. And this happened in England. In 1578, 65-year-old widow Elizabeth Stiles was charged with witchcraft. She was a beggar in the town and a widow. Her husband had died. She had no way to support herself. And when people wouldn't give her coins, she would shake her fist and yell at them, which in some ways makes her our first internet Karen. But that's a conversation for another day. And her very odd reputation in town was kind of enhanced by the fact that she had a pet rat. That's an unusual pet, even now in some ways. It was very unusual then. Well,
not helpful with the getting of money either, I would imagine.
One day she begged a local innkeeper for food because she was so hungry, and he refused. And not long after that, he became ill, and the innkeeper became convinced that Mother Stiles had cursed him. So he approached her and scratched her to make her bleed, which was a surefire remedy against the curse she'd laid on him if she was a guilty witch. Blood flowed and the innkeeper recovered, but they arrested Mother Stiles. And once they had her in custody, Mother Stiles was like, oh. And she described how, along with 3 other old widow outcasts, she had been practicing magic, basically creating voodoo dolls. Well,
Mother Stiles, no, don't do it.
Mother Stiles and all of her accomplices were tried in court, found guilty, and hanged on February 26th. 1579. Old, deformed, marginal women, poor women who lived alone, who no longer had any beauty, who perhaps had physical ailments, those women who had only an animal for companionship. That was the beginning of the popular culture image of a witch. And we have Mother Styles to thank us for the witch costumes that we dress our little kids and ourselves in today.
That's really amazing. And you know what it comes down to? They didn't know what to, we don't know what to do with mental illness today. And they sure didn't know what to do with it back then with Mother Styles.
Well, also, let me just point out, she was a poor, hungry widow.
Yes.
Maybe give her some freaking food and she won't have to curse your cheap. But
do
anyway,
you think that she suffered because of her look? She couldn't get the food and people turned their backs on her because she was not an attractive person at the time.
You know what? It's
very
a good
possible.
Question. And
yeah,
I don't
very
know.
Possible.
Or maybe because although, as Jesus taught us, the poor have always been with us. People that didn't give a damn about the poor have also always been with us.
Yeah.
Isn't that also equally possible?
Well, she did not help herself. She didn't help herself by talking about making witch's brew and then walking the rat.
Well,
I'll tell you that right now.
Either way.
Good to point that out.
Thank you. I mean, I've worked in advertising for quite a while, and that's not one I would sell.
Either way, she's the reason why we think witches look the way we think witches look.
That's
so think about that, especially if you're planning on being a sexy witch this Halloween. Think about that and give Mother Styles some credit. We'll post this up on Facebook. It's Bob and Sherry.
Leave us a talk back with the free Bob and Sherry app.
Well, over the years, we have kidded, mostly me, about my abilities. I have very, very powerful abilities to skip out on a party whenever I'm ready to go. And so when I saw this article online about socially unacceptable things that should be acceptable, I stopped right away. And the very first one was about leaving without an acceptable song and dance when you're ready to go from a party. You have basically reached your limit with socializing. But having reached your limit with socializing is not a good enough reason. And so you have to come up with, you know, some BS line of why you're, Hampton has a terrible fever. We have to go. The dog, I swear the dogs and cats get it all the time, and not just from me. The dog, we can't leave the dog more than an hour and a half. He tears up the entire place, whatever it is. But you know, you should be able to just kind of get up and say, I have had just the best time. You know, you're there 90 minutes. I've had the best time. And you should be able to go. But I guess people are really turned off when you leave their party. You can see it in their face. It's like, what? This is not a good party? You don't like us? You don't like my friends?
You're allowed to leave. But when you show up an hour late and leave 25 minutes later, it'd be better if you didn't come at all.
25 minutes is not acceptable. I agree with you. What is acceptable without having to go through a song and a dance?
45 to an hour minimum, I think.
Really?
I think an hour.
Unless you're on your way to your kid's soccer banquet and you've already said, oh, Tina, we wouldn't miss it, but, you know, Scotty has his soccer banquet, but we're going to do a drop by. Yeah, unless you've set that up in advance, you have to stay 45 to an hour.
Don't you always think those are lies, though?
I don't because I'm easy to lie to, I guess, but also because I know that people have lives, right?
Yeah, I guess. It'd just be so, you know, why don't they just say, why do people have to have parties that go on forever? I'm bringing this up because we're getting close to party season coming up. Why don't they just have parties that are like 90 minutes? Mary and I had a little street get together I told you about, you know, about 3 weeks ago, something like that, and got all the neighbors there, you know. And it was like 90 minutes to an hour and 45 minutes. It was perfect. Now, I will admit that Mary kind of put it together, so I'm tied into it. And when the first person picked up the folding chair and started heading to the car, I was a little, I don't know, disappointed. Oh, you're leaving right as it approaches 90 minutes. Okay.
You yourself have left people's parties much more quickly than that.
Well, they had a lot of shrubbery in the back of the house, and I was able to fit through without causing a problem.
You know what's funny? You were saying that people disappointed. I've never hosted a party. I've never hosted a party.
Come on.
Now, I have had people over for, I've cooked Thanksgiving dinner before. I've had people over for Christmas. I've had people over to eat. But I don't know that that classifies necessarily as a party. But a traditional party, I have never hosted one.
Is that a party, having them over for Thanksgiving, Sherry?
It depends on how many people did you have, Max?
I would say through the course of the day, we probably had 15 people come through.
That's a party.
That's a party
for sure.
Yeah. Okay. But you've never had something where maybe there's some hors d'oeuvres, there's some music playing, and everybody's going to be chatting
for three hours
with drinks.
Never concerned myself with making sure what the music was right and the drinks are right and none of that. Uh-uh.
You selfish thing. Why do you put the rest of us through
this
hell?
You know why? Because some guys want to come late and leave early and are uncomfortable to be there to begin with. That's why.
Well, who are these?
Boy, I hope I don't know anybody like that.
Some people.
What? Jeez. It's Bob and Sherry.
Now, let's open up the Bob and Sherry Archive Vault.
Oh man, Brian, I can't wait to talk to you, Brian. You're a pilot, huh?
Yeah.
I can't believe that you can't stand working with a co-pilot.
It is a very unique situation because you can't escape.
Well,
talk to
also,
me, I'd be a passenger.
It freaks us out to think that you two aren't getting along up there.
No, you know, it's not that we don't get along and we get what we have to get done professionally. It's just that his existence sitting there.
The existence of getting there with the co-pilot.
What's so bad?
I'm never going to fly again.
What is so bad about this co-pilot?
He shows up and everything about him just disagrees with everything about me. You know that?
Oh, yeah. Bad chemistry there.
Just the way he dresses, he's not a small guy, but his uniform is about half the size it should be.
Mm-hmm.
He doesn't seem to see that.
Mm-hmm.
The way he breathes into the intercom microphone all day.
Like, what does he do? What does it sound like?
Oh, I can't. I have a very sensitive gag reflex. I can't do it. It just...
The way he breathes?
The way he breathes irritates me.
The way he talks, his voice.
So he does something like this.
Attention, passengers. We're going to be flying at about 30,000 feet this morning.
Does he use that, you know, generic Oklahoma Chuck Yeager sort of voice?
I don't let him make announcements.
So you're the pilot.
Because you can't stand the way he breathes and talks.
Hey, if you're the captain, why can't you get him transferred?
It doesn't work that way. It's all seniority. You know, just kind of, sometimes you end up with a whole crew for one day. Sometimes you end up with an entire month for 4 days at a time. And I see him on my schedule for an entire month. I can't wait. I have been at 37,000 feet and contemplated jumping. It was that bad.
I'm never flying again.
That's it. That's it. Hello, Amway.
I will say this. He gets the job done professionally. He is a perfectly competent pilot. That is not in question. We're talking personality.
Does he say mean things to you? Does he say uncomfortable things to you?
No. Is
he like Michael Scott on The Office? He just grates on you?
His presence just makes me... He asks very dumb questions. And outside of the aviation thing, he's kind of adrift in the world. He doesn't think... You can see him thinking. Have you ever met someone where you can see their wheels turning in their head, and they're about to ask the dumbest question you've ever heard in your life?
Excuse me, Brent. Sherry, the co-pilot is adrift with his thoughts.
and the
captain wants to bail out.
Yeah.
Where does that put me in seat 23F?
Being yelled at by the flight attendant for not turning off your phone.
Now you know what the F stands for.
You can hear more from the Bob and Sherry archives at bobandsherry.com.
The Bob and Sherry website, the Oddcast, contest info, bobandsherry.com.
So Halloween is not that far away, and I was interested in this story because we are getting close to Halloween, and it comes from the Peabody Museum. It is a museum that I grew up very near in New Haven, Connecticut, and they have the most amazing dinosaurs, bones that you have ever seen anywhere. But also they do other things, and they have just opened an exhibit that spotlights the Salem witch trials.
Ooh.
And we've all heard about the Salem witch trials, but what do you really know about them? I've been to Salem, Massachusetts, in the witch house where one of the women who were accused of being witches, you can take a tour of. And it's, you know, a house from the 1600s, right around 1690. And it's very interesting. And then you go to downtown Salem, and it's a charming place, but of course they're playing off the whole witch thing, and there are Halloween stores, and they kind of make it a little bit lighter. But the actual trial itself was a really serious thing. I'm just going to read from the Peabody Museum. Before being executed on July 13th, 1692, Elizabeth Howe, along with four other women who were hanged that day, endured trial proceedings that would soon become infamous. Since the early part of that year, the community in and around Salem, Massachusetts, was roiled by a series of witch trials that threatened the very core of the Massachusetts Bay Colony. And again, this is in the 1600s. Families and friendships were ripped apart. It involved eventually more than 400 people and led to the death of 25 innocent men, women, and children. The wife of a farmer in nearby Topsfield and a mother of six was charged with, quote, affecting several young women, including a 10-year-old girl who complained of being pricked by pins and suffering from mysterious fits. Acrimony defined the trial as a number of Howe's acquaintances and loved ones came to testify against her, overriding her denials. And then she met the rope because of that. And now, more than 300 years after the trial, Peabody Museum's newest exhibit, The Salem Witch Trials, Reckoning and Reclaiming, runs through March. And it features original 17th century court documents that are accusing these women, in some cases men, of being witches. We're still thinking about the witch trials, they say. After 300 years, we're still reckoning with the fallout from the trials and what it meant to these people and how we think about those people and what they experienced in 1692. There's a book, The Memory of Elizabeth Howe, 1692. And you can read about what happened to her and what she was charged with. It really is one of the most shocking things in the nation's history.
When you dive into it, you realize that it had nothing to do with witchcraft at all. Not really.
No, no.
You know, witchcraft was just the excuse.
Right.
The fake news, right?
It's a
really, one of my daughters got very, very into the history of the Salem witch trials. And so we have a handful of books around the house on it. Yeah, it's...
Oh, is that right?
It's something, yeah. Oh, there's a shock. One of my daughters interested in witch trials and feminism. Who'd have seen that coming ever, right?
It's an interesting town to go to. I mean, it's as charming as can be, and there are restaurants. Everything is witched in the downtown area is mostly witch-themed. But it's a charming New England town when you get to it. They have, you know, the Salem schools, and I wonder what the mascot is, right? And let me correct myself. It's the Peabody Essex Museum. I believe that's somewhere in the area. That actually may be near Salem. I guess they're associated with the Peabody Museum in New Haven. So
wow.
The Peabody Essex Museum, the Salem Witch Trials, if you want to look it up, and if you're an aficionado, maybe it's a great place to go for vacation for a few days.
I'd love to. I mean, I've never been. I would love to go and just walk around and people watch and kind of soak in the vibe. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's interesting. It's Bob and Sherry.
Leave us a talk back with the free Bob and Sherry app.
So this time yesterday, I forget how we got on the subject, but I told Bob that I had seen Sir Mix-a-Lot performing Baby Got Back with the Seattle Orchestra. You know how YouTube is? Like, you sign on to look at one thing, and then 2 hours later, you're watching Sir Mix-a-Lot. So yeah, Max found it, and it's really wonderful. Let me set this up, and we'll post this video on our Facebook so you can watch it. So Sir Mix-a-Lot, who's from Seattle, is performing with the orchestra, and he brings all of these women, he asks for volunteers, women, to come up on stage for Baby Got Back. And when you look at, this is a symphony performance. So it's women dressed up to go to the symphony, and it's those women. Do you know what I'm talking about? And
I know exactly. Exactly.
They come trucking up on stage to dance as Sir Mix-a-Lot sings. And here it is.
What? I like big butts, and I cannot lie. You other brothers can't deny. When a girl walks in with an itty bitty waist and a round thing in your face, you get strong. Wanna pull up, drop, cause you notice that butt was strong. Deep in the jeans she's wearing, I'm hooked and I can't stop staring. Oh baby, I wanna get with ya and take your picture. My homeboy's trying to warn me, but that butt you got me. Ooh, rock a smooth skin. You say you wanna get in my bins? Well, use me, cause you ain't that average groovy. I seen her dancing, to hell with romantic. She's sweating. And I'm tired of magazines. Saying black butts are the thing. Check the average black man and ask him that. She gotta pack much back. Where's my fellas? Fellas! And your girlfriend got the butt. Tell him to shake it, shake it. Shake that big old butt. And baby got stuck. Yeah. He's smiling his ass off. I like them round and big. And when I'm throwing a gig, I just can't help myself. I'm acting like an animal. Now here's my scandal. I'm gonna get you home. And double up. I ain't talking about Playboy. The silicone parts are made for toys. I want them real thick and juicy. So find that juicy double. Mix-a-Lot's in trouble. Begging for a piece of that bubble. So I'm looking at rock videos. Not me bimbos walking like hoes. You can have them bimbos. I'll keep my women like Flojo. I want to the big soul sisters. I want to get with ya. I won't cuss or hit ya. But I gotta be straight when I say I want chill the break. Come on, baby, got it going on. A lot of simps don't like this song. I'm getting punched like to hit it and quit it. And I'd rather stay and play. Cause I'm long and I'm strong and I'm down to get the friction on. So, lady, yeah. You wanna roll my Mercedes? Yeah. Turn around, stick it out. The whole room got to shout. Baby got back. Twenty-four, thirty-six means nothing to me at all. Only if she's 5'3", you know what I mean? Yeah. So your girlfriend rolls a Honda, playing workout taste by Fonda. But Fonda ain't got a motor in the back of her. Sing that song. You can do side bends or sit-ups, but please don't lose that butt. Some brothers wanna play that hard role and tell you that the butt ain't gold. So they toss it and leave it, and I pull up quick to retrieve it. So Cosmo says you're fat. Well, I ain't down with that. But your waist is small and your curves are kicking. And I'm thinking about sticking to the beanpole dames in the magazine. You ain't in this thing. Give me a sister, I can't resist her. That means that I should miss her. So I'm not ahead trying to diss. Cause there's girls are on my list. He had game, but he chose to hit him. And I pull up quick to get with him. So ladies, if the butt is round and you want a triple X, throw down. Jump. Oh, baby got back.
See, if this were happening at more symphony performances,
listen,
I think more tickets would get sold.
This is why they're doing it. A symphony got to do what a symphony got to do. I think since that went over so well, they ought to bring out Cardi B to do WAP. You know, that'd get Grandma's eyebrows up a little.
I'd like to see Grandma get up on stage for that, the way all these women did for Sir Mix-a-Lot.
Sherry, when we post this, you must go see this because this is my favorite thing. Watching these women dance around here that have gone to the symphony is my favorite thing in a long time.
I got to see it. I haven't seen the video yet. Will you send it to me?
It is amazing.
It is so, it will make you so happy to watch. I just clicked send and it's posted on our Facebook right now. This is this Bob and Sherry.
Get Bob and Sherry swag in our store at bobandsherry.com.
So just a few days ago, Ellen DeGeneres began her final year of the Ellen DeGeneres Show. It has been on for 19 years. And one of her quotes was, "It was a fun show to do, but it's not a challenge anymore. As great as this show is, as fun as it is, it's just not a challenge anymore." Let's hear just a little bit of Ellen DeGeneres.
I like that you dance when you get scared. So before the show, I put out some Ellen products with a sign that said only one per person. And I just wanted to see how honest my audience was, you know, because it turns out you're very honest. Very, very honest. We set up really amazing.
Celebrities scheduled to appear on the show this season are Jennifer Aniston. Also, Jimmy Kimmel is going to make his 30th appearance. Melissa McCarthy will be there. Diddy Combs, Melissa Etheridge are all booked for episodes early in the season. It's interesting. She just did an interview with The Hollywood Reporter where she said it wasn't a challenge. I think actually it is a challenge doing that show. I think that the negativity probably must have weighed on her a little bit, and she certainly doesn't need the money. Last year doing the show alone, she made $84 million. And she is worth, according to Forbes, a minimum of $370 million. It could, by some estimates, be $600 million. And Portia de Rossi, her partner, has her own $50 million fortune, which brings the celebrity couple's total net worth to $420 million minimum.
So I guess we can shut that GoFundMe down.
Pretty much.
They're going to be able to make the house payment, y'all.
Other people who are going to go on this year to say goodbye to her, at least her show, not her. Meryl Streep, Bradley Cooper, Jennifer Lawrence, Julia Roberts, Brad Pitt, Kevin Spacey. And let's see, what else? She's just had an amazing and continues to do an amazing job with her career. Whether you thought that she was mean or not, I don't know. I didn't work for her. She was in Finding Dory, Finding Nemo. She has done a whole lot. And it's really interesting that her career was almost over when she came out. She couldn't get phone calls to be returned. And then slowly it turned. And then when she was dropped from the Situation Comedy Show. But then she came roaring back with this. And that daytime show has been on since, 2001?
I should know better than to ever believe any hype. And I should know better than to think that celebrities are who they claim to be. But the news that Ellen is not a nice person hit me hard. It really did. I was super unhappy and disappointed by that.
I think everybody was surprised.
But it had been rumored about for a long time. And when you heard that, you went, I can't believe that. I find that
exactly
hard to believe. And then there was it seemed like there was a tidal wave of people coming forward going, yes, this is true.
Yeah. And when the stories first started coming out, you know, Ellen's mean, Ellen's awful. I thought, please let this just be like just people stirring the pot and not have it be true. But it wouldn't go away. And I mean, it's just come from so many places that you feel like, well, there must be some fire where all that smoke is. And she tried to come back from that and couldn't. And that's why the show is ending. Not because
it
isn't a challenge to do anymore. Not because it isn't a challenge.
Right, right. And plus 19 years, that's one away from 20. I mean, wouldn't you go for the 20 if you had been doing it that long? I think most entertainers would.
Isn't she emceeing? There's a game show that she emcees, and I think she produces it. And I think that's probably what she's going to continue doing. I don't think she's
going
away.
That's exactly what I think.
And it's a better transition than her just having to be herself with guests.
She's way into real estate too, and interior design, and apparently is like a savant at both. So Ellen is not going to be wanting for income or something to fill the days. That's for sure.
No, that's not the point. It really isn't the point. I mean, she's won the awards. She's won daytime Emmy awards, Golden Globe awards.
Yeah, prime it might just be Emmy. Over. I mean, who cares, right? Yeah. Just
I think
because
Max
she's done
right.
all
I think,
of that in the past.
I think she's going to do voiceovers, and I think she's going to do game shows, because there's no personal interaction. You just, you know, you're the host. So that's it. One more year. It's Bob and Cherry.
Hey, thank you so much for listening to the Bob and Cherry podcast and the Bob and Cherry Oddcast. We would love if you would subscribe, rate and review, and share it with a friend on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, wherever you go. And thank you again for listening.